Thank you, Ross and Dale, Gil Kasla, and Olechka. My best effort is the language of the locals. Just acknowledge all of you as respected ones. And in my language, to this new name of people, we acknowledge that we are here on your territories. And in fact, I want to begin with just a real expression of respect. There are ceremonies that have been going on this morning. For those who've arrived and didn't know, lots of you were here throughout the morning. Know that there's work on grief and loss and ceremony that are being conducted by some of the leaders, the cultural leaders of, amongst our peoples. And it's been happening and it'll continue happening even as we sit. We've experienced the loss on campus as a campus family, and it happened to be a close relative of mine. In the way that we talk about a loss, Cosmo Mit means he was. And it's been sad. There's also been other losses in our families back home. So it's with that, it's with a tinge of a sense of sadness and grief that we begin our conversation with you this afternoon. And when I say we, it's because I'm here with my, since we saw one another last, I did as some boys are wont to do and got down on one knee and I asked Heather Marie, I says, Heather Marie, will you marry me? She said yes. Ask her and ask that we share this this work, because that's how we carry out our work, and it's going to be a bit of a theme from Tsawak to Atla, because that's what comes after Tsawak, which is one in our language. Philosophically, we'll talk about the oneness of life and the connection between all of us from diverse backgrounds and of the living world around us. In fact, our elders will say even the stones are alive and should be respected, and they're connected to us too. The theme of our work these days for Heather and I, who share this work in the Shwequa here on campus, is it's the power of connection. And that's a bit of a theme, the connection that's happening through ceremony. The feeling of loss that comes when you've lost a loved one. Ya'ak stuff, that idea of to love one another. Ya'ak will also be a theme here for us, love. Why? Because when we experience pain, it's because there was love. In the language of the New Chonal, love and pain are the same word. The ancient wisdom that when we're open, when we're vulnerable to loving somebody, that the moment that's not there hurts. And so I acknowledge those of you who are still grieving. And for those of you who suffered losses in your families, you'll know what that feels like. And a moment like this might touch on that pain. We acknowledge your pain if you've experienced loss in your life. And so in the next little while here, a few minutes today, I want to encourage you, first of all, don't be shy to go back up and get your coffee or get your snacks, or there's some cookies, I think, still not much left over there. I didn't want you to worry about milling, because amongst our peoples, it is okay to be eating and to be getting your food. The way that the elders in my village will talk about it, it's because when the speaking is happening, the thoughts that are being shared will be more easily digested as the food goes down and nourishes the body and the soul. And the theme that that Dale and Jen, that you guys had, we talked about, was really to situate this conversation about really a contextual lens. I would say what was, what is, and what can be. The theme that we've really looked at is because of this year being Canada's 150th birthday, it's a pretty young country compared to home on the West Coast. We don't look at it in terms of 150 years, we look at it in thousands of years. And some of us can trace our lineage back 27 generations in our homes here on the West Coast. But that was the general framework, was the 150 years that we've inherited. So what's our work? When I say ours, I mean all of ours at this juncture in the history of this country, this land that we now share. What have we learned about ourselves up until now? What's our work in this generation? Because this is it. It's no dress rehearsal. You get one shot, just like your ancestors and mine. And what do we want to leave for our descendants? What does the next 150 years look like? What are we hoping will be accomplished? What is the vision that we can start aspiring to for that next juncture? So quickly for my part, you heard a little bit of the bio, that is sort of the professional bio, but I just turned 50 in January. I was like, yes, I mean it. And I was excited to turn 50, and I was sharing this because of the accumulation that you start to learn a little bit about yourself, and I mean that in all honesty, a little bit. I can't imagine being more grateful for what I've learned in life, with the experiences that I've had the privilege of having, including the hardships, including the difficulties, including the failures and the wins, more failures, more falling on your face, but choosing to be in the arena every single day. And you've heard a little bit of the snapshot of that. But I wanted to share a little bit more because the journey lately has been such a personal one, and our theme is very personal because Heather and I do all of our work together. We do our work together, like the story of Kista and the story of how whales were hunted just several generations ago on the West Coast, where the partners would work together in complete harmony with one another, as husband and wife at that time, to be able to go out and secure resources for the people, which at the time was a whale. So it was a physical manifestation of resources, which today is now expressed in things like education. It's expressed in things like some business leadership friends here. It's expressed in going out and acquiring opportunities. It's you going out and getting your education. It's you being instructors and faculty and creating an environment that shifts us from a history of only being really focused on creating human capital for market economies to now being more actors in a more civil society, more civil world. And the theme within the theme that Heather and I have really touched on, and I want to ask her to offer her opening thoughts here and her own introduction, is that 150 year from the past and 150 year going into the future, what we like to maintain is that we're moving on a trajectory in this country from a period of tolerance where it's like, I see you, I think we're probably different, I'm not sure, but we're going to make space for each other. To where we're at now, perhaps a transition into something called mutual accommodation, where I see you and I see that your interests, and I now see what your interests are, and it might be different than mine. Can we accommodate each other's interests? Your business interests, your focus, you see what my interests are, and there has been some inequities over the course of history. Can we mutually accommodate? To where Heather and I are hoping that universities like VIU and student leadership, the likes of which this institution helps to encourage out into the world, will move us back to where our ancestors and where the original founders of this country began those conversations on the shores of the eastern Atlantic seaboard, traveling up and down the St. Lawrence Seaway, when the early visitors to this new world needed help from COAS to survive those first winters. Real connection. Real seeing one another for dependent, very dependence for survival for life is the earliest relationship. So in fact, what's new is old. What was then is now coming back to the forefront. And we're going to touch on a little bit on that, talk about the place of a university in that broad context. So these are our opinions. I have been liberated from a political past. 3 years of healing. This is where I get to continue my healing journey with you here today. So just like to ask Heather, please, if you would offer some thoughts. Whenever we do this work, we do it together. We've been doing this a long time in our professional lives together, and only recently have moved into being together in our personal lives. And so it's in that spirit that we do this work.
Thanks, Shawn, and thank you everyone for welcoming me as well. I was here last year and we do our work on campus together. And as Shawn touched on, we do all of our work together. And it's people always ask us, you know, how and why, but for us it really is the expression of our teachings, our ways, and how we've been oriented together always for doing what we call the work. But it really is no disconnection from who we are and the way that our work starts at home with us, and then we look out to the world, we face the world, and and we do this. So Shawn's touched on it. We've done our political work together for the last more than a decade now, actually. And I've always been, we have this great synergy where we build thoughts, we build on each other, and we get to face and bring out. And so now we're starting to do a bit more speaking together, but it's always been that way for us. And we really believe that, you know, we've got some thoughts now after being in the deep political aspects of the work, and then our journeys through the different places that has taken us, and now offering back, as Shawn says, you know, some opinions, some suggestions, some reflections, some observations, some curiosities that we feel are starting to get unfolded as we move through this journey, really touching on notions around the age of emotion, this concept of what is old is new, and how we bring it and weave it together, this integration of a cohesive of an integrated narrative. How do we bring together these seemingly disconnected stories and pieces and find a way to bring them forward as an integrated whole? And so that's a bit of what I think Shawn will do the primary touching on through the speech today and through the talking back and forth and hearing your reflections as well. And then I'll offer some interjections or some reflections as we go, because that's kind of how we do it. But really, you know, focusing in on that age of emotion, you know, the really what is possible, and vulnerability, courage, safety. Those are going to be some of our kind of main themes that we're going to highlight. But really, you know, with that forward-looking feeling of hope and optimism of really what we believe is emerging.
And I'm going to brag up Heather a little bit. And when we say safety, we're not meaning protection. I now know after close to 20 years in electoral politics that what I was really trying to do was to keep my little brother safe from some of the hurt that would happen in our homes. I was trying to keep family members safe, and I was trying to protect them. Sacrificing and being absorbing pain so that others wouldn't. And realizing now that actually that's not what our responsibility is. They were misplaced, but I didn't understand. Just like when we were home supporting the family through the grief of the loss of late Cosmo, that what we witnessed at home, first of all, is the beauty of the vestiges of a powerful culture come through, with ways to grieve, ways to mourn loss, and structures. We keep the curtains closed at night. The streets are to be cleared. Our security forces will be out patrolling to make sure that everyone stays safe. Be home with your family. Encourage you not to cry late at night. You're going to, perhaps. However, we would ask that you do that in the morning when the sun comes up. And when you do cry, you gather up those tears and those tissues and you burn them, you send them to the Creator. So just a little insight to what a housed grief structures might look like. And there's a lot more to it, but I'm touching on something that has to do with the very real part of life, which is also death and loss. And I heard an elder speak at home recently, and I was thinking about the disruption over the last 150 years of brilliant, beautiful cultures like ours or Suname and others, other indigenous cultures here. And one of the elders in his pushing 80, I think, stood up and said, "I'm just learning how to grieve now. I'm just learning how to grieve. I am not ashamed for a moment to express to you that finally at the age of 50, I've got 4 or 5 years of good grieving under my belt, finally. Losses of senses of feelings of neglect, not feeling loved or protected, feeling unsafe, having your hands out, a lifetime of anxiety. I didn't even know that I suffered from this acute amount of anxiety. But there's an app for that now, so if I feel a panic attack come on, I go to my app, and it'll have me do 5 things. It's like, oh, there's standing over there, there's people talking over there, there's a chuckle over there. I look at that red, the beautiful red. I see that it's a little bit bright outside, that's 4. My feet are planted on the ground, that's 5. I'm in my body, I'm right here with you. I feel confident in my skin. But it doesn't mean that at age 50, that I don't have feelings of anxiety, that I don't get afraid. Or when I'm excited about something, so excited that we're getting married this fall, but excitement sometimes will flip over to anxiety, and I didn't even realize that was happening to me. These are seemingly simple things. And of course, I've been functioning. Listen to all the so-called accomplishments. And I'm honored to have those. But are you? Can you feel the sense of dissonance, the disconnect? There is no place lonelier than those sorts of roles, like the office of the national chief. There is no place more difficult or isolated. You find yourself really alone. I could walk through airports for years, and slowly it's starting to diminish here. Shawn, Mr. Atleo, A-in-chut. And you know, people see you on the screen, they feel like they know you, and we'll have very intimate conversations. Or they're comfortable throwing rocks at you through social media, which is the other thing that happens. And then that would set off little triggers of shame. I didn't know I was carrying it around, and I work with a therapist now. Heather and I go see somebody together. We share this openly, yeah, periodically. And I remember my therapist explaining to me that, Shawn, you really need to grieve. So I'm thinking about where we've landed at this juncture in 2017, the 150th anniversary of the country that did things like take my dad away to residential school, where he witnessed a fellow student at the age of 5 have their tongues pricked. I think about my late cognizances, my late uncle's passings lately, and we're very careful about how we talk about it in our immediate family. We encourage the sentiment of death or passed due to suicide, as opposed to words that might interpret judgment. It may seem like a small thing, and you may have different perspectives based on your own orientations, which the elders will always respect. And they were reflecting back to me, Shawn, when you talk, you know, always remember that people come from different backgrounds, different cultures, and look to your own family's narrative, which is what Heather helped bring out, that this is our work, that when we're home, we think that we need to acquire, and this is where the university can provide leadership. We do not have an integrated, cohesive narrative in this country on this topic. We're beginning to acquire it, but it's brand new. Now, for a moment, think about your own personal narratives. I ask you to go too deep here, but very often we don't have our own personal historical narratives. I'm beginning to get one because I'm lucky enough to have my mom and dad in my life still. My dad is going to be 79. Mom is 10 years younger, and she's a professor, going to be retiring soon from the University of Manitoba. And she's telling me all kinds of new stories. I just love it. Thank you, Mom, for sharing this with me. And we've had a very difficult past, but we've worked on the interfamily healing through things like forgiveness and dropping the hot coals of anger that we were raised with, because I realized I learned that it's just hurting me mostly. And freeze your hands up so that you can reach out, you can hug, and you can shake hands. The idea of having a historic, integrated, cohesive narrative. Where do I come from? Whose am I? I remember when I was a little kid in the village with wrinkled eyes, and Dave, I'm not even sure how it was said to me, but I remember being spoken in our language. Whose are you? And I remember it used to drive me nuts. Don't you want to know my name? No, they wanted to know who do you come from? Where do you come from? Oh, okay. And then I'd have to scramble. I couldn't remember Dad's first name and Mom's first name because they're just Mom and Dad. It's the vestige of a beautiful ancient way to relate to one another, to stay connected. Ah, ha, 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 ha. I remember my late great grandmother. Ah, ha, ha, ha. A real ahosit way to express love. When you're sitting on a grandmother's lap, because every once in a while I'd be asked, how did you make it? I think of those moments. Like we talk about, there's one or two people in our lives that helped us along the way. Parents are important, aunts and uncles even more so. But the power of a granny, come on. Grandfather, right? I mean, I think most of us, many of us, can have felt that. Even if it's a grandparent or aunt or uncle figure that are not our blood relatives, there's been people that we've looked at. But maybe you have others that you can relate to. So when we were home, getting back to bragging up Heather Marie, I remember years ago, my village had a suicide crisis. I believe I was just starting my journey in the elected political realm. I was a regional chief for British Columbia, and we had lots of attempts, and we had some completed suicides at that time. And I remember our people just said, we can't cope. We can't do this. We need help. And it was like that. That's how it felt to me. And we reached out. We had people all the way to Prince Charles said, support resources, and there was art programs that happened in the school, for example, but people came. And it's proving to you that, and to me, that people do care, you know, whatever a neighbor is going through. If we understand, we want to help. That's just the nature of people. I think people, by and large, care. We care about each other, we care about one another, we care about our neighbors. And when we did that effort the last time around, I remember it created a shake, and things did, it did, we did sort of awaken to the gaps, and the policy gaps, and the funding gaps, and the needs. And the fact we're on this long healing journey, it touches on things like education, referenced in the opening, and I ended up having that tagged on to me, even if my main interest was the consciousness of the country. I accepted the mantle of education leader, or the education chief. Because to me, education has the opportunity to move from it once was, to inculcate, pour knowledge in you so that you can go out and get a job in a particular sector, to be an active liberator, to support you, to ask the right questions, deep questions, the difficult questions, the ones that disrupt, the ones that really allow us to hum mutz up, to open up the curtain and see what we're actually dealing with, so that we're no longer just sort of on a track anymore, where things are predetermined for us. And it, I've learned at the age of 50, it begins with myself. So when we were home grieving with the family, we were working with Dave. This is our leader at home. When I have needed support, I go home and I look to you. It's one of our senior leaders amongst our people. And I know that, like Dave, we come here, some of us, with a heavy heart with our losses. And we too need support. And that's one thing that we saw this last week. In 2005, when I was elected regional chief, I thought I have to give expression out there to the hurt that I feel and to try to protect people. And I was still on this track of trying to make things better. And I was so focused, so determined. And one of the first things that I did is I sat down with leaders at the provincial level that had never been sat down before by the office of the regional chief. We signed a unity accord. It seemed to be a breakthrough. And I thought, we just try to have to work together. It was common sense to me. And then we signed a deal called the Transformative Change Accord with Prime Minister Paul Martin and at the time Provincial Premier Gordon Campbell. And we created a whole bunch of new institutions. Because one of our observations, Heather and I make, is you think of the institutions that have grown up in the Western world in countries like Canada. Governments, municipal, federal, provincial, chambers of commerce, advocacy organizations for minerals, for forestry, for energy. And for Indigenous peoples, they would go to the chief counselor. And if there was an issue with dogs on reserve, they go to the chief counselor. And if there's an issue with forestry, go to the chief counselor. If there's an issue with any of those things, they come to the regional chief and to the national chief. I heard about all of those things. The main point that I'm making here is the lack of institutions that have been there to support our people, that reflect our people. So Vancouver Island University in the year 2017 is on a bit of an indigenization, whether you know it or not. We don't have to call it that. I don't want to freak anybody out. But by virtue of the reality of what's happened in the last 150 years and what we've inherited, because this is an institution of learning, this is a place where the consciousness is now raising. And the education leaders are embracing it and integrating it horizontally and vertically. That's exciting to me. It's becoming co-SIs to the point where we can have ceremonies adjacent to the room we're in, led by Indigenous spiritual and cultural leaders. That makes me feel good to know that we're on this path. Back to the bragging point, I'm still getting to. When we were home, in this deep grief moment, we were meeting with the leaders. And in 05, when I signed that accord, and Heather and I were working on that, and I eventually went off to Ottawa, to the Office of National Chief, that accord included initiating some work, including the transfer of help from the federal government to the 203 First Nations of British Columbia. Sounds easy. 203 First Nations agreeing to anything? Are you kidding me? I was national chief. 203 First Nations, over 90%. What was the final tally? It was over 90% said yes. 187 out of 203 First Nations said yes. That was a bold, vulnerable move. So to accept a $5 billion transfer, 300 staff transfer, three collective bargaining units. How many have heard about that? Right? Oh, there's a few. Because it doesn't bleed, so it doesn't lead. You've heard a lot of other stories about Indigenous state relations or Indigenous peoples. And I'll only speak to First Nations. I have very limited experience working with my Métis brothers and sisters and the Inuit leadership up north. I can only speak from my own orientation, although I did a lot of work with those leaders, both provincially and federally. The point that I wanted to make is here I was at home, grieving with the rest of the family, offering leadership support like others, like Dave. And this work that we've done with the Health Council, the protocols kicked into place. Heather picked up the phone because she oversaw that negotiation and the implementation the whole. And it was a major piece of work. And it's an example of the kind of work that's been going on in recent years, especially in the last decade, as awareness of the policy gaps have been coming to rise. And when we were finishing, when we were leaving, we thought, okay, those, all that pain, all that hard work, I had to talk to the CEO, talk to the senior policy people, and made sure that our relatives at home are supported. So that the director, my aunt, could at least rest for the weekend. So that the youth council was open, I think 24 hours, I think, at home. And there was brushing offs happening at home too for our families who wanted it. And some of the family had left because there is back-to-back funerals and it's just so hard and it's just so heavy. That's a small example of the kind of work that we've done. That is an example that doesn't garner headlines, and we don't need it to. We just want to work together. We want the real recognition to occur. So the First Nations Health Authority got created, and they then linked with the provincial system. And what we did is emphasize to our friends in those leadership roles is make sure that you are there to support the house it leadership. You're not coming in and draping. And because they're oriented as Indigenous people and leaders, it felt good that they were able to do that. And we got caught on a boat because it was sunny. And we haven't seen sun in like a month and a half in the mainland. And we got on a boat. And we went with our little girls, Rainey and Sienna. We harvested 30 crabs and we brought some to the lodge for the visitors who were there doing the healing work. And we said, feast on some fresh crab. And the whales were playing and the sea lions were looking fat and happy because it's herring time. And for those of you who aren't familiar with the patterns and the rhythms, this is the most delicious time of year for us on the West Coast. We were out ready to go harvest a hemlock tree to go put in water, which is the way of our people. And being out on the water was such healing when you're grieving so heavily, to share with a 6 and 4 year old girl the story of hemlock, who was got up late, didn't listen to the instructions about getting up early because pine cones were being handed out by the creator. And hemlock was trying to budge to the front of the line. Who knows budgers, right? We all know budgers. We experienced them. Maybe we've been them. Didn't get to the front of the line, so I had to mopingly go back, sent to the back of the line. The girls are really listening because we're going to go get hemlock tree to put in the water. And so hemlock has this really sad story about ending up with the littlest pine tree, sent to the back of the line. So if you don't know your trees, now when you go out, you look at the trees and you see the one tree with the top hanging down, you'll remember the story of hemlock. How special it was and how much healing it brought to a little visit home to support grief and loss. And the young ones, we don't invite them into the funerals to a certain age. They're not welcome to be in. They're already thought of to be close to grief. After a certain age, then they're welcome. That's just a little insight about the culture of a house, some of the work that we've been doing, and what we believe to be the link to the work here. Talking about Omar, knew him as a student, now faculty, working with colleagues here. And we're just sharing with Omar this sentiment around this trajectory of moving from tolerance to mutual accommodation to real connection and real attachment. Heather and I are also in business together. We felt strongly that the world of business was where we wanted to bring our constructive disruption, although we don't tell any of our business colleagues that's what we're doing. We believe that we need to work from successful enterprise, successful business relationships. And at the very high levels, we saw how business leaders in Canada would make plans to go to China or overseas. They would have long stints where they would hire consultants to make sure that they got the cultural protocols right. And I was sharing a story about leading a trade mission to China, and we particularly were going to Beijing. I was thinking about the polls that we got out here. And we had commissioned a poll, and we talked to the then GG, Mikhail Zhang, the Governor General, to help bring this poll to Beijing. You may remember the story back in, I think it was 2011, that we were thinking that maybe we got the date as 2011. They had a horrific earthquake, and an entire village was lost. It was buried. And our people were touched like most people around the world, but we ended up commissioning this pole to bring to them as a healing gesture. And it did get erected, and we met the elders. We were there when this home for elders was being opened, sponsored by the Government of Canada. And we brought out our drums to celebrate the opening of this place, and we felt the mourning, and we visited the site where the earthquake had buried their village. And then they quickly ran and scurried and got their drums. And they were starting to do their drum. And we were seeing one another. And it was so beautiful. They don't speak two major languages that we think of as being China. They spoke their own indigenous language. They were indigenous peoples from the Beijing part of China. And we forged a link there. A really powerful link and an interaction with the people there that is maintained to this day. A side story is that I was sharing with Omar that I had to appoint a drinking envoy. And there were some of the business meetings where the cultural business protocol is this toasting protocol. Now, mind you, the glasses aren't filled up tall. You know, they might be just this high, but they're shooting these glasses of wine. I can't do this. This isn't going to work for me. So I grab this big Indian from the prairies who was okay with being my drinking envoy. And so we would walk around and I would do the protocol and then hand my drink over and he took care of it for me. And I was clear-headed the whole time, which is good for business too. You know? It's a very good strategy, I think, that happens in some business circles. And I was reflecting then, and now even more, we've reflected on it. The business leaders will say, Guan Xie, we need to understand Guan Xie. That particular business culture that we're interacting with has relationality at the highest level. So it's you have to get to know it. That's really important. Those same business leaders would very often turn and look at their opportunities in Canada and see that they're within the Canadian construct. Not necessarily be see, or because they've not been supported to see the cultural differences and the legal differences, mostly the legal. Because Canada has been seen as a place with the rule of law. So you know what it takes to acquire permits to build, to develop businesses. I think about the aquaculture industry here on the West Coast, or forestry, etc. And however, in the interim years, we've had an accumulation of 200 Supreme Court cases and provincial and federal Supreme Court cases. We are on the single biggest legal winning streak around the world. There is no group in the indigenous peoples of this country who've won more court cases around the world. And so, something to be, I think, probably at this juncture in the country's history, probably thankful for. Because it's not happening in other parts of the world. The struggles are still very deep, even if they're led by indigenous leaders, as some countries and places in South America. But that's the confluence that we find ourselves. 200 court cases. Heather and I just got appointed within the last 3 weeks as co-chairs for the Chilcotin Chiefs title implementation case. They're the first and only indigenous peoples in this country who have over 1,000 square kilometers of recognized title, mm-hmm. not encumbered by crown land. Mm-hmm. So, for example, what do you do with the BC Hydro line that cuts across it? You have to rectify that. That was an old tenure that's now been displaced. It does not have crown title underneath it. This is Chilcotin title land. wow, like that blows us, this whole concept, right, of forever being encumbered by Crown title. That case did that. But it's only one of 200 court cases. So this is what we've inherited. We've inherited this idea going back to the times of Champlain and the trading that would go on and the treaties that were forged across the country, treaties 1 through 11, pre-Confederation treaties like right here, the Douglas treaties, the Royal Proclamation, which is now 250 years old, which was the earliest inception, the earliest sentiment of real recognition and real respect, and it was formal. We're still working on it. It's a work in progress. We've inherited that as well. But I wanted to share that story because Heather and I really believe that at this moment, the work that we've come from, that idea of tolerance, where we just coexist, it's like we're neighbors and we wait to mutual accommodation, where we're now beginning to figure out in cities like Vancouver, you're going to have to figure something out because of the cost of housing. We're going to have to figure out how to relate. Right? It's probably going to be higher density the way it is in places like Europe. Something's shifting. That idea of having, you know, your own single dwelling as a go-forward sentiment, it's just not there anymore. So I think about my great-grandfather's day when you had four or five family units within one big house. So we were this stakum, a bunch, to translate it, the Atleo bunch. And we would be cohabitating with other groups. So you think about the future of humanity. We got seemingly a lot of space here in Canada. It feels to me like many would feel like that's not going to happen in, you know, my lifetime. I don't have to worry about it. But we're on that trajectory of moving towards tolerance and mutual accommodation to really determining or figuring out how to live, to work, play, do business with one another, how to govern as well with one another. Because the systems that we've inherited also don't facilitate the seeing of, in this case, Indigenous peoples make up First Nations, particularly 4% of the national population. So we've got deep inequities. Those 200 court cases are starting to shift the balance, but the inequities are deep. And they're perpetuated by institutions. They're perpetuated by the systems. I think if anything, what Heather and I like to suggest we're in the business of doing is encouraging, facilitating, directing systems innovation and co-creation, where attachment comes in. Well, let's talk a little bit about what that takes, because it takes some heavy lifting. And we believe we're in what we refer to as day two. And we preface it by saying this: it gets awkward. It's going to get awkward. It's going to be uncomfortable. There's going to be some squirming, including institutional squirming. And it's going to feel inconvenient. And it's messy. And that's where we are right now. And guess what? This is the work. It's not out there. This is the real work. It's heart work. It's the, as Heather says, it's the age of emotion. And at the age of 50, I'm finally discovering how to identify and how to express the emotional realm that I know now that I've always had. But I didn't know what I was bottling. I didn't know what I was swallowing down. I didn't know what I was expressing, including the fears about joy and looking forward to things and happiness, because that might be taken away as well. And now it's joy most of the time, I'm happy to report. Joy most of the time. And there's a liberation that didn't just start the day I resigned as national chief. Got on my Harley and rode for 35,000 miles. I think I was a hint toward the liberation coming. But there's an inner freedom that started to emerge because of this sentiment about innovation. And here's how we feel it goes. Heather will jump in and add or correct if I missed something. Real innovation requires boldness. Real innovation requires vulnerability. Boldness and vulnerability require trust. Trust is hard to come by. I had a hard enough time coming to realize I could trust myself, nonetheless another human being. So once we arrive at a place of real trust, then the potential for real attachment comes in. And then dependency. What about dependency? Like those early first relationships expressed in the treaties. I'm not talking about codependency or enmeshments or unhealthy boundaries. Like taking children away from their families and putting them in residential schools. I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about putting Indigenous peoples on enclaves called reserves and then telling them they got to get a pass that they have to go. I'm not talking about not allowing them to hire lawyers until the 50s. I'm not talking about those sorts of things. You get the theme. We're moving, coming from a place of the deepest level of unsafe, unhealthy, enmeshed relationships at the structural and personal levels. There is a swath of destruction that has accrued. And if there's one testament to the power of the ancestry of Indigenous peoples, or the vestiges of a powerful culture, it's that we're still here. We're still here. We're still struggling. We're still suffering. As Rick Hansen, my good friend, who wheeled around the world, said to us when we met with him recently, he's one of our closest friends, he says, "Shawn, I still believe I'm going to walk one day," he says. He said this to us. He said, "I'm not cured, but I'm whole." That's a sentiment that I've now adopted from that good mentor. I am not cured, but I'm whole. Mm-hmm. And I'm worthy, and you're worthy. And you're enough. We haven't had that sentiment expressed to us. So we're here to reflect back that you're enough. Each and every one of you. You're perfect just the way you are. The challenge is to accept where we've come from. Acceptance is difficult, like accepting the loss. The mind does not want to accept that I'm not going to bump into my late cousin cause on campus. It's only weak, you guys, so it's still wrong. It's tough, right? The mind doesn't. But our structures, they keep reminding us to remember reality. It's a healthy thing to do. And just like grief and pain and anger and suffering are contagious, so is joy. The act of smiling. Go ahead, try it. Put a smile on it. If you're willing to be bold. Right? See how infectious it is. It moves around the room just light. So as adults then, and as institutions that forge that attachment, that parental-like attachment, particularly to students, your hearts and the spirits and the way in which you carry, conduct yourself is infectious. And it's important. I grew up in an era where, unlike many of you, the attachments were principally peer-to-peer. Kids raising kids. Learned how to cook when I was 4, 5, and 6 because the adults needed somebody. That was a reality in a lot of our villages growing up. And maybe in other cultures and other family narratives that you come from. So we didn't learn healthy attachments. Of course, how can you when children are taken away from the village? You have generations that are just now rediscovering it, and I've got elders 20, 30 years older than me just telling me that they're just learning how to grieve. And when I'm talking about grief, by the way, I'm talking about the messy kind. Like, I'm talking about for 5 days straight, I would get up and have my breakfast, my first cup of coffee, say, "Heather Marie, I'm going to grieve now." And from 9 until noon, I grieved heavily. My body shook, and the tears came pouring out. My therapist said, "Shawn, when you're doing this work, I want you to imagine that you're pulling off tar. It's going to feel yucky and sticky and ugly and gross, but you've got this, and it's stuck all over you." I would take a break. Oh, that was hard work. It's real work. This is the work that we're in right now, more broadly. I would have lunch. "Heather Marie, I'm going to grieve again." And from 1 o'clock till 4 or 4:30, I went at it again. And it felt like it was just grief for a lifetime, but grief for generations of hurt and loss and suffering and disconnection and pain. But it was real. I needed to be introduced to this notion of grief connected to shame. That idea of being shamed. I now realize how vulnerable I was when I was national chief. With the advent of social media, you know, one nasty comment would send me reeling, even though I knew that it couldn't possibly be true. I knew in my heart that it shouldn't bother me. But you put your hands up if you think that you're completely immune to any of that. So how we treat each other, how we talk to them, the power and the difficulty with the way social media will connect us, but how disconnected we are at the same time in terms of real attachment. Talk about real human connection. Yeah, and that idea that none of us can, you can't see your back. And if we have a close attachment, I can say, "I can have your back. Would you like that?" Okay, so here's our understanding. I know Heather's got my back. And we remind each other, you can't even see your own face as you sit here. You can't even see your own face. We really need each other. At this juncture, this idea that my father encouraged through his writings of Hishup Nishtzawak, we're all connected in one, is a powerful connector at a philosophical level and a large level. Because it's true. It's true scientifically. It's true at a quantum level. Those are all true. And what I felt, or what we felt, is generationally we inherit that sentiment about interconnectedness and say, okay, well, now apparently what comes after Tzawak, one, is Atla, the power of two. That idea of being dependent. I'm dependent on you. Different than codependent. A healthy dependence allows for me to be free and liberated, to be finally free of the encumbrances of that very oppressive internal world that I inherited. And the anger, I shared that story the last time, and some of you were here when I came back. It was my now 30-year-old son who said, Dad, you have to go to your first business meeting. I've set up a new corporation at home, and the first meeting will happen on such and such a day. I went, and there was two mummifly guys, and in our language, we still have this divisive language. It's today referred to as white people, but it actually doesn't mean that. It means people who came on floating big homes, which was another vernacular for boat people. So the original people of the West Coast are still called mummifly, because they came and they came via Captain Cook, and there were these people who came on homes that they were living on. It was so foreign to our people, you can imagine. 2017, we still have that vernacular. Dave, we need to find a new vernacular for ko'as, because ko'as in our language means human. But we refer to it only as ourselves. So even in our own language, we have to look at the hurt and the anger that's come and how we talk about one another. That sense of distance and division. And the idea of truly leaning in on one another. So differentiating what we would suggest is a very enmeshed, unhealthy boundary relationship with the state between indigenous peoples, who even as national chief, I would have to go and submit funding requests to the same government that I was trying to advocate, sometimes against. Well, that was Prime Minister Harper. Yeah, I took that one. You're welcome. I did my very best. But the structure, can you feel the enmeshments, right? The way, and it's the same thing right through the entire system, because communities are funded by federal governments. And one of the objectives is to reassert historically what we were, which was independent, self-determined peoples with laws and with governments. We still have to this day a federal government who is, by the way, head very proudly by an indigenous woman from the island as justice minister, who's inherited a Department of Justice that to this day does not recognize our peoples. So we still don't have the formal recognition that can get us to the structural atla that we've been searching for, which is nation to nation. We're having to return to it. But as Heather's reminding me, that idea of leaning in. Oh my goodness, you mean that I gotta stop going lone wolfing it? Oh, I can do this on my own. I got this. That sort of a tough front that so many of us have put on for so long. I got this. It's okay. I don't need anybody. No, I need somebody. I really need somebody. I'm glad I've got somebody, and we have people in our families and in our friendships that we can rely on and that we have trust in and that we can talk to, have real conversations. I have real conversations with my own folks now. Is it relevant to this? We feel it's entirely relevant. The micro family dynamic that I'm referring to, I know will resonate with many of you. I have real conversations with the very younger brother of mine that I used to hide underneath the bed so he wouldn't get hurt when we were kids. He tragically lost both arms in a BC Hydro accident. And he's going through a struggle right now that we're supporting him. But we're connecting as brothers for the very first time. He's just 3 years younger than me. That's the story of our people. I traveled most of this country and visited villages that sometimes it felt like when I walked in the village in northern Manitoba, it was like I was walking into a house in 1975. That's how it felt to me in my heart. I'd walk in and children would be looking after themselves. And there would be honey buckets, slop pails up in the front porch. Just felt like a house in 1975. This is still a reality in this country, but you know, we also talked to philanthropists recently who, Slate family talked to us, and they're asking us our opinion because, you know, they're turning their attention from only putting money in overseas projects. And they just put $12 million into Indigenous peoples here in this country, focused on young people and education. And it's that beginning to move from the tolerance to the mutual accommodation to the real attachment that's starting to happen. That idea that we are going to need each other looking forward the next 150 years. We've inherited a period of history here. This country was built really on an early Indigenous mutual recognition and respect, leaning in and depending on them. I never thought that I would be standing in front of people saying that this is the work that we've got in front of us for. I'm excited for it, though. I'm excited because I see its results institutionally. I see new institutions being created, like the First Nations Health Authority is just one. They've created all kinds of institutions. Look at what we're standing in. When my dad spent 10 years instructing here, he couldn't have imagined that we would be standing in an Indigenous gathering place with ceremonies happening. One of the first institutions in the entire country to have elders recognized as faculty happened right here. That's what I'm talking about. It's so exciting to us. We attended the Educators Forum. Somebody helped me out with
Westcast.
Westcast. We attended that forum. And I sent a note to my mom at the University of Manitoba. I said, "Mom, the horse is out of the barn. You've done your work." We've got a cousin who's graduating in 2 weeks, and she stood before us and she said, "We're going to make sure the language of a house survives." It was Carissa. Carissa, she's graduating from here, and she wants to go home. And even though we don't have all of the funding yet for all of the educational aspirations, we don't see that we've got it. We've got this incredible determination that's arising in the generation represented by Carissa and my own children, Tyson and Tara, who we're not letting this go, and Canadians as well. I am convinced that this horse is out of the barn nationally. When I left the office of National Chief versus when I started, I remember when I took office, they used to tell me, former National Chief Fontaine always wanted media. He could never get the media to pay attention. By the time I was done, I'd had it with media. I don't want to talk to any more media. And I haven't talked to hardly any of them in 3 years. I know that the radio was here, sorry. But it's just the truth, because our stories weren't being told. Not the real stories, the stereotypical stories, the stories that led because they bled about hardships, about trauma, about pain, and about suffering, and about corruption. Those stories we read about over and over and over. And so you ended up with a snapshot, and I'd be sitting down with a prime minister or a minister, and they would say to me, "Well, Shawn, isn't this the case?" And those one, two, or three stories would always come to the surface. So then we should just do this, and it would always be a fix from the outside, always the fix. So you're hearing some excerpts from the book that Heather and I are writing right now, because we do want to talk about these things. We've been at tables that not very many people have the privilege or the audacity to end up in, and then come out of there having felt so much hurt and pain, but knowing that this journey has been worth it for the learnings that have occurred, and that we want to encourage and support and show VIU that this place is demonstrating leadership. In this entire country, I was so honored to be here as chancellor. Former board chair and Ralph came to my island and housed it. The way that we culturally do things, and they brought a gift. And they asked me to be chancellor. Here we go again, a big volunteer. Okay. Couldn't say no to anything. But if I do this, if I get elected national chief, it means it's going to be a stretch. I want to. And so the focus then, it always has been on education, with education being the title that is about learning. And the journey that I myself have taken, and I think that we've taken in our professional lives, is working at that high level and saying, actually, no, it needs to come from here. It's got to come from this room, from the relationships that are possible right here in this room. It has to come from the business relationships that where friendships are forged, where trust is built, and where we can be bold and vulnerable, and where a new economic model is emerging. It's not even written about. We get to see this at the multiple hundreds of millions and billions levels in this country. There's a new economic model that is emerging in this country based on the acknowledgement in the marketplace of Indigenous title and rights. even if the policies aren't keeping pace with it. So, smart universities will want to be out front of it, and I believe that that's where VIU is situated. Still a long ways to go, we'll all always admit, but nevertheless, that idea of this university, 75 years, achieving within itself, not just highlighting the very best, just the way Canada has, no, an integrated, cohesive, historic narrative. What has been this institution's role over the course of that 150 years, of which 75 years it's been a university? What's our job? What's our work right now? We're suggesting it's that messy part now. The glory years of it's just the Wild West and you can do whatever you want, it's all over, done. There's a new era that's occurring now, and we can constructively, I feel excited with great hope and lots of excitement and joy, move into that space. Because what was once complex and seen as the Indian problem, and I heard that more than once, my own ears, I heard that more than once from senior business leaders here on the West Coast, going back 20 years, is now being recognized as a complexity for sure, but an opportunity. That's the original concept in the shores of the St. Lawrence Seaway in the Atlantic coast when the need was the other way around, when those newcomers were coming to new land. And they needed help figuring out becoming oriented to the new world at that time. So there's a new world order that's emerging here. We believe that the anchors of this have to do with the sentiments and the ceremony that will be happening next door. And that is to acknowledge the spirit, acknowledge the emotional, acknowledging each other as human beings with real fears, real anxieties. Make no mistake about it, we only get to see the best 2% of each other. That's it. We don't see what's happening. Not in these instances. That's where the real connection comes in. And that's where the university is a place that can feel so foreign to anybody, whether you're an international student or coming from a housing. The passing due to suicides that our village has experienced have mostly been in the urban settings, right? We were talking about that. They've been in the cities, in the Victorias, the Vancouvers, and the Nanaimo. So even though we've got really strong, Indigenous peoples are the highest per capita users of social media. So that idea of connecting, wanting to connect, is absolutely there. That's an expression. Well, we're talking about the real, the opportunities for real human connection. We know it's scary. We know it's difficult. I know it's the scariest thing I've ever been through. But I'm okay sharing this with you because we feel this is also the time for family, for institutional, for community leadership. It's a new era that we're in and it's talked about at a national level. We've got leadership with Bell Media talking about let's talk. The idea of exploring the emotional and the mental realm, the war of the minds and hearts, not to stigmatize this, but to talk about it, that we mostly just need to talk. Because that's, if we have a safe place to talk, we have a chance for not to end up over strictly in the medical profession. There's an acknowledgement of the need for that. But you see where we need to go. That's what we're feeling is really needed right now, is real human connection. Moving from Tzawak to Atla, that the 150 years that we've just inherited have been one of deep disconnection institutionally, and at the human and the heart level. People like William McDonald, if you've seen his contributions in the Globe and Mail, are moving us forward. And this is a good friend of ours, by the way. He's in his late 80s, and he talks to us about Mackenzie King because he knew him. He's been around this guy. I didn't know that Canada was run in part by a handful of elders who were in a boardroom in Toronto since the time of Mackenzie King. It's incredible, the things that I've had privilege to see. A bit scary. And I think we need to question the systems that we've been here. First past the post electoral democracies, the way in which we choose leaders and leaderships. And I believe the path we're on is taking greater control in our local territories, having a greater say over what happens in our own backyards. Call it NIMBYism, call it all sorts of things, but it's about us having a greater say going forward. Being more conscious, more aware of our relationships within this country. Moving away from having things done to us and co-creating a path forward. When Heather and I do work, we co-create. We encourage VIU to co-create with the Indigenous leaders, to acknowledge the institutional power that this institution is inherited. It was legitimate, for sure, because that mace demonstrates it. It came straight from the crown, which is why the first act that I did is put a paddle side by side. Both can be used in different ways. Now, the paddle can be used to propel us forward, but I chose the type of paddle that if you turn it the other way around, it's a weapon, because that's the original concept of the mace. It doesn't make a very good paddle. So I gave that paddle to student leadership, to the union leadership, to the university senior executive, to faculty. The only way forward, you guys, is to work together, is to recognize our connection, our interconnectedness, kinship means sawa, but to actually find real attachment that we depend on one another. This university is going to have to figure out a way forward. It's become more difficult on the funding streams. I've watched as university presidents have fought for smaller and smaller piles of money. Part of what Heather and I are doing with the university is helping with a capital campaign. So when there's new projects that are happening, that money comes from somewhere. More often than not now, it's coming from the business community. And so having those relationships become more integrated, more local integrated relationships is what the hope and aspiration are. And I think lastly, I want to sort of conclude with this global thought, because I've marched with 24,000 Adivasi homeless poor people in India in 40 degree heat. I've walked with the people smelling the decomposing bodies in the shores of Banda Aceh as the indigenous people were being dispossessed of their land under the guise of martial law, and using the tsunami as cover, they were going to remove them from their land. And we went in without the support of the Canadian government. And I stood side by side with those local leaders. We got Finland to help, and in the end, they ended up being able to stay in their land, and we helped facilitate the Scandinavian leadership to come in and broker an end to the civil war that was happening in the post-tsunami time. We've sat with indigenous leaders in Peru whose lands have been decimated by companies from Canada. Over 800 mining companies headquartered in Vancouver alone. We've had those indigenous chiefs say to us, can you help us? We're not against doing business, but we never want it done the way it's been done before. We don't want it done to us, we want to do it together. This is the moment that we're at where this university on this island, in this country, is poised to provide leadership in this space for the entire globe. So I'd said to Omar, now that you're on faculty, I pitched him a proposal. We sat with the new ambassador to China. We said, you know, the Chinese and the indigenous peoples, we built that railroad. People died in the Fraser Canyon. And there's intermarriages now with Chinese and indigenous peoples in the Lower Mainland. Late Milton Wong was one of my best friends and biggest mentors. He was the inspiration for the port work that's happening up in Kitimat. He was HSBC, he was chancellor at SFU, one of the most prominent Chinese business people in Vancouver. He's been gone for some years now. We did some cultural protocol that I referred to earlier in Bechuan. I said to Omar, what about if VIU was the portal for indigenous Pacific Rim relationships, especially China, because of that old relationship, because of those deep connections, in the end, intermarriages, about people who, like my late friend Milton Wong, who walked with the leadership up the North Coast and said, you know what, Guan Che, we get to know one another, we forge a strong relationship, anything's possible. And that dream is in large part being realized. That's where it came from, all of that development talk, all the controversy and all of the hope, the potential jobs and the billions of investment, all came from the early relationships. That's a British Columbia story, Chinese indigenous in that case. So I'm gonna end on that sentiment. I'm sharing with you a pitch that I just made to Omar like 20 minutes ago. That not UBC, we love UBC, I took part in my master's degree from them. Not SFU, research filter schools, they've got a role to play. But what about an institution embedded, anchored in community, with international reach and scope, small, nimble, able to move, directly connected with local business leaders? What about this being a place where we have an initiative where indigenous peoples help to provide that portal and direct business relationships with overseas investors? We've seen how those conversations happen at this level. They fly back and forth, and it's just like they miss all of that richness and that potential for deep connection and understanding. And as a result, failed investments in the hundreds of millions we've seen in this province in the last couple of decades alone. So missed opportunities, some might consider it, others might say, well, that's good, indigenous peoples are doing their part and helping to shape, for example, an energy economy differently than the way it's been. Others would argue that way. What we're saying is that it's the time for the kind of connection and the kind of innovation in the business and economic space, that it builds on those basic principles that we're concluding on. That it's the age of emotion and connection. That we require real innovation. Real innovation flows from boldness and vulnerability, which has to be anchored in trust. We have to be willing to accept this history that we've all inherited. The difficult part and the beautiful part is never too late to have a happy childhood. You might not have heard me express that, so let me say it again. Never too late to have a happy childhood. I could go on endlessly about the happy aspects of my childhood. The love that I have had now for my parents, for my aunts and uncles, my grandparents, my late grandparents. Now that's the richness of the opportunity that we feel and the inspiration that we feel. In no small measure are we suggesting that this is going to be easy. And we do need people to be prepared to step into this place and embrace the messy, embrace the uncomfortable, embrace the really awkward, and embrace the pain, just like we embrace and accept the pain of losing a loved one. There is no way, as our four-year-old said, singing out loud, no way over it, there's no way around it, no way under it, the only way is through. But on the other side, there's a sense of potential peace and freedom and liberation and creativity, and might I add, the infectiousness of joy and hope. It's just sitting right there for us. It's what came to me one day when it was whispered in my ear. I'd ask the question, what does it take to be joyful? And the answer came, be joyful. No? Okay. Now I remember that, more days than not. And if I forget, I've got an app for that. So in our language, we say true, which means okay or goodbye, aona, which could be translated a number of ways. I usually say short speech. That's it for now. Thank you.
Tim, yeah. Hi, Tim. Your word from the beginning to the end, I cannot stress enough as I sit back here and listen to you as an elder. You have covered delicate words of advice, delicate words of emotions, words of wisdom from your community to the audience, but also embraced it with humor from your own experience. I could not just sit here without giving you my thoughts. At the age of 50, I must say, you have grown. When you became the chancellor, I remember that day very well with our late chief and I being there to embrace you, to welcome you. I, being a wife, grandmother, great-grandmother, I know when our dear Kolasowicz here, her teachings around, when your mind awakens, you know that time when it comes. All of that beautiful teaching, the Snow White comes. It's meant for those in the audience sometimes to fill their pockets. And you have done so well today. I've watched you over the years. Your role has grown. And the strength of it I see at the age of 50, you say, so young. I sat with Doug and Doug III over the weekend, and we're planning for Auntie's big day coming. And the three of us were sitting around the table and we celebrated our birthdays. And I said, golly gee, I'm 65. And Doug, and I won't tell his age because he's a little older. And he said, oh, I remember when I told you I was 60, you wouldn't expect me to be an elder. But here you're 65 now. And I said, yeah, and I'm an elder. Well, we'll see about that. We'll have to bring you to the men's circle. Because there's a protocol. But hello? The elders in my group call me a young elder yet, so, but I'm wise elder. Got the wise. But I really want to embrace and raise my hands to you because you come with great wealth, great wisdom, and it shows in your words because you speak from the heart. And that I see. And the journey that you're on and where you're going within other communities, carrying the words, the teaching to help them in their, where they're going. We as Douglas Treaty, we have those leaders too, like Doug the Third, and because as he, as young as you, has that wealth that we embrace so well. I just thank both of you for coming and sharing. Hi, Jeff.